just going through and talking a bit about the work.
We'll see later more and more of these pieces. Do you want to start, Jeffrey, with any portion of it?
Well, this is some of the highly carved pieces I've done over the years. I think we should maybe start with this piece up here.
Okay.
Because it's one of the older pieces. About 9 years ago, we were involved in a gallery in New York, and working in conjunction with them, we did a series of mirrors, this being one of them. And this is made out of poplar and mahogany combination. And over the years, as a carver, I've become known as combining two tones of wood together in a figurative manner like this. This is the pieces I've been known as a carver of. This piece is called Crystal, and it's a series of 9 pieces, which are done over a number of years. This is another piece called Sybil, about the same size.
So they're about 2 foot high.
Yeah, that I think this one here is about 2 feet in diameter, something like that.
And then you put a bevel glass mirror in.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
And then the collection culminated in this larger full-length mirror, which we call Sarah. And the frame of this mirror is oak. This is red oak and mahogany and poplar combined together. This piece is about 7 feet high and 40 inches wide at its largest point.
1, 2, 3. Okay, I can see it better now.
Yeah. Most pieces that I do are sort of a technical challenge as far as working is concerned. This piece is used in a slideshow as a documentary on carving techniques. And one of the challenges here, when you laminate wood together, you have to laminate it with the grain. Otherwise, you get grain separation. So this whole hair piece, from here down to here, the grain is running up and down the piece like this. So all of this had to be carved across grain, and it had to be carved in layers. In other words, in order to carve the under pieces and the more delicate things, like this here, for instance, is all cross grain. It had to be carved on jigs and specialized techniques in order to do this piece and still be able to carve it. This piece here, the figure itself is almost three-dimensional. It was meant to be much shallower, but when I got into it, it got deeper and deeper. The glass is a topaz bevel glass, hand beveled piece.
Those are 2 pieces of glass or 4?
Well, actually, there are 6.
6? Okay, it breaks at the top.
There's 2 pieces on the top, 2 pieces in the middle, 2 in the bottom. The style of these mirrors is Art Nouveau in stylistic taste. The whole idea of the flowing hair and the combination of woods and the use of the nude and so forth, they're all Art Nouveau style characteristics.
Start right now. There we are.
At about the same time that we were doing this full-length mirror over here, also doing the Pegasus piece. This piece is also done mahogany, and the horse itself is poplar, and the wing is pine. And the knot structure you see in the wing is a continuation of the knot in the wing. The same piece is cupping inside of each other. It's all sewn on the same piece.
Okay.
About 5 years after the first Pegasus piece was made, a client of ours saw this, the original piece, and asked us to make another Pegasus piece. This one here is much larger, and it's made of almost completely exotic woods except for one part of it. The wing is made out of English, the section in here is made out of English cherry wood, and then we have inside of here is American cherry, some bass, some padauk, and the husk itself is made out of maple. The mane is made out of pal amaretto, which is from South America. And this is a type of pine here. This is beveled mirror, also topaz color. This would be a close-up of that piece.
Oh, that's beautiful. All the different colored woods really make it a lot richer.
Yeah.
It's too bad it's not, you don't have the piece. The photographs really don't do it justice, I'm sure.
Yeah. I also have a model of this piece, which is 3/4 the size of this.
Okay.
The original piece is over 4 feet this way.
Oh, it is.
The model is 3/4 that, which is, you know, three feet or so. This is called Beelzebub. This is a commission done for a gallery in Amherst, Massachusetts. Beelzebub is the beautiful one. It's not really the devil, it's really the demon. And it's characteristic is one curly foot. Of course, the ones. He's made of mahogany. As far as mahogany, most everything on him has mahogany except for his wings. In fact, he is much better. Maple. Sits on the tips of his wings as far as intensity of the piece makes it very difficult to cast. So in making it, I engineered it, keeping in mind how it would be cast. So we just, I designed it so that the wings could be taken off the piece. So in the back of this, can you see that, Aaron?
Yeah.
In the back here, there's an access hole and some bolts up inside of here, so we could take the wings off so that they could be cast separate from the piece itself. Now the design of this particular griffin is inspired by a griffin which is on the museum in Pennsylvania. One of the more characteristics of that particular griffin is the double ears. It has lion's ears and then another set of ears, sort of nondescript, but they also are ears. And I sort of really enjoyed looking at that, and that's one of the things I really wanted to put into it.
Fabulous piece.
The other aspect of this griffin is that when I originally designed it, it was designed as a table support, so that you could use one or two of them under a glass table. So it's therefore 32 inches high, which is standard table height with a piece of glass on top. We cast this in fiberglass resin, which is now commercially available as a table piece. And then we started to develop this further. First of all, I made a column for it to go on, which is a hybrid of a fiberglass piece which was already cast and a wood piece belong. And this was all cast as a column for it. So now we have this whole piece cast as a piece. And then a continuation of that theme, we then added a piece on the back of the griffin and up above the ears so that we could use it as a support for an archway.
Yes.
This is the first version of the archway. As you can see from the photograph here, this is the piece that we just described. Column and the griffin, and then we added an archway to it, into here, down to another column and griffin, and then some urns on top of that structure. This is another picture here and show with us standing in it, give you an idea of the scale of the piece. Okay, what happened from there is we decided to make it larger. This here, you can get this on the camera.
Mm-hmm. No problem.
I don't know what you're trying to focus on at this point, but...
The four.
The four section, okay. Mm-hmm. So what we did is we take, this is the section you just saw, right there, and we added a section in the middle. So now you have an archway which is three sections, 22 feet long and 12 feet high. Now also what we added to make it 12 feet high is a 2-foot section on the bottom of it, which is in character with the column. And this is all cast in fiberglass and being sold commercially. Very exciting. And hopefully to do more parts of pieces like that in the future.
Here we go.
This is a bed commission that was done by a collector, for a collector of ours. This is a king-size bed with a male and female figure holding up a canopy made of bentwood laminate. Very much like a bentwood laminate chair is made. 16-inch veneers, pieces that are laminated together in stacks and then cut into strips. Mm. This is a closer look at some of that. This is the male is made of poplar. And the other stuff you see in the photo is mahogany. Photo of the back of the laminate.
There you are installing.
Yeah. This all comes apart in just sections and reassembles like a jigsaw puzzle with fasteners that are hidden.
Well,
after that commission was accomplished, which I never thought in my wildest dreams I'd ever have another one like it, about 3 years later, another client came along and saw those photos that I just showed you. It commissioned us to do another bed. So this is the second version of the bed theme, kind of. Except that this is much simpler with a male and female figure facing each other on a canopy. It's much open and simpler. These are flower structures here, as you can see them very well. And again, the bed, backboard of the bed is relief with flower structure. Very Art Nouveau style bed piece. One of the pieces that are finished for this piece is this, the male, which is on the right hand side, your left hand side of the bed. He's, again, he's made of poplar. And the flower is Kermabuka with Halha, Amadeir, Arrow, pistils. And his hair is long. Into this commission and the collective commission debt went through bankruptcy, and so we were never able to complete this bed, although many parts of two essential parts of it are completed, and that's the backboard section here and the male figure which you just saw.
Is it about two-thirds life size? Half?
Yeah, something like that. Yeah, it's about two-thirds. He's, I guess if he was standing up, it would be about 1.5 feet high, something like that.
Beautiful piece. And you say you have the backboard of the...
Yeah, if you can focus on this here, this section here is also completed. I don't have it here to take photos of, but... this part of this section is down from here, down to here.
Up to a joint. So the headboard is done.
The headboard, yeah, basically is done.
But you don't have the little side drawers.
No, the side drawers are side and stands are not done yet. And the female is partly done, yeah. The headboard is has a red mahogany feel with Kermabuka flowers and Osage orange stamens. In other words, what you see red here is actually yellow, and the flowers themselves are red like the Kermabuka that's on this, this flower there.
So what's red here would be?
Would be yellow.
Yellow.
And this section here, I don't know if that's what you're focusing on, would then be red. I'd suggest would be red.
Yeah, it's so much richer once it's made in full dimension.
Oh, yeah. This also is an engineered model to give you not only functions as a model, but also functions as working out the engineering. section I just took off is actually the mattress. And this would be the box spring here. Take the box spring out. And this gets you a feel of the engineering of the bed itself.
Okay. Well, it's a complicated structure. How big a room does it take? How much ceiling height?
The bed itself, the highest point would be 8 feet, 6 inches. It was originally meant to go in a 9-foot, 6-inch room. And it would have occupied, that would be the only piece of furniture in the room, basically. It's a showpiece.
It certainly is.
I can talk about
there
this.
There we go, I'm on. I should shoot the man from some different angles.
Well, I can talk about that if you want. Are you?
Yes, I'm shooting.
Are you on?
Yep.
When you do figurative sculpture, especially in wood, one of the essential things about it, of course, is a lot of advanced planning. So before touching this piece of wood at all, first of all, I started with drawings from live model, and then go from live model drawings to three-dimensional sculpture, which is about half size of this piece, and then in clay, and then from three-dimensional clay, we had to make a plaster of the three-dimensional clay, because that's the model that you use while you're carving the figure. Since it takes months and months to carve the figure, your clay would deteriorate by the time you got the figure carved. So you now have a three-dimensional model of a figure that you're going to carve in plaster. So that's advanced work to starting on the initial carving of the figure to start with. And then you have to figure out from a wood standpoint technical challenge of laminating pieces in order to get ready to carve. This has four laminations in it of 2.5-inch poplar. And I don't know if you can get this, but you can see some
sure.
of the laminations lines in here. So each one of the laminations has to be engineered in advance to making the figure.
Surprising. I noticed that none of them ever open up. Seams well, always stay smooth.
Hopefully you do it right. I mean, you're asking wood to do an awful lot when you do this to it, because you're changing the dimensions and the dynamics of the structure of the wood so dramatically by the removal of material.
Right.
When this started out, it's probably twice as large as what it is now. You probably
waste half
the material that you start out with. So it's quite a challenge. You have to be really careful, because once you remove it, that's it.
Yeah.
There's no turning back.
It's a very large composition, quite a figure. Like you say, it'd fill a room. That's
you
fine.
Concentrate on this?
Okay.
And just start with that.
Okay, we're on. Is that a pheasant or?
Well, we call it a fantasy birds. We did a whole series of these. My wife and I, for many years, had a limited wood production business. We did all sorts of butterflies and flowers and stuff that we lived off of while making more expensive stuff. And this is just one of the pieces that was done as a production piece. And really what it is a spin-off from some of the stuff that was done earlier. If you can focus on this is a, you can see that or not?
Sure. As soon as the camera stays there, it's working.
Okay, this
that's
is
Lynn Lee.
That's Lynn Lee, my wife. And this is a peacock. It's standing on a pedestal.
My God.
And this again is made out of all exotic woods, different types.
That's about almost 7 foot tall.
Well, yeah, it actually is more than 7 feet on it, so pedestal. This is another maybe some closest to that.
So the pedestal itself is quite a work.
Oh,
focus. There we go.
Can you focus on this piece here?
Yeah, I'm focusing the camera a little bit slow at times.
You okay?
Yeah, it's working.
Right on. Maybe you can, if you're on this one here, you can see this is made just like a bird would be made, where the flowers, the feathers of a bird, are a progression from the head of the bird to the tail of the bird. So all of the feathers are made individually with different exotic woods, laid over the top of each other like a shingle on the roof
one
of a house, one at a time. Starting from his tail all the way to his head, basically. And in this particular case, we're finishing up on his neck here is a different combinations of mahogany and badouk in combination, and then up around here, the crest under his eye is pallid and moretta, and his eye itself is ebony, and his beak is walnut.
That's a beautiful piece.
And the crest is, again, padauk and pallid and moretta.
So you could make any piece you wanted. Any bird that someone wanted, you could do a stylization.
Oh, yes, and we've done... We made other birds. One series we made was of a goose with combinations of woods combined, which is very popular. We sold quite a number of those. This particular bird is made with combinations of wood. He's got an ebony eye. This is a Palo Amaretto again for his beak. We have mahogany, poplar, ash, a duke, and this is a cherry. It's more cherry. His legs are made of copper. Copper combination.
So we've pretty well looked at the woodwork that you still have in the house, haven't we?
Yeah, most of the commissions and stuff, the heavily carved stuff, we've covered. The collection of carved things that I have done.
Representative well.
Yeah.